Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk about area. Pinning down what an area is seemingly easy, but a little bit tricky. There's an obvious notion which doesn't quite work as well as you might think. The obvious notion is to use little squares. So we work in a grid plane situation. We say that a little square or cell has area 1, and then in terms of that we can create areas for a lot of other figures. For example, a rectangle like this will have area 6. Half of it forming a triangle will have then area 3. And we can get the area of a general triangle, for example this one, by judicious cutting and pasting. The area of this rectangle, then subtract the area of this triangle, and this triangle. So what do we really want this notion of area to satisfy? Well, first of all, the area of an m by n rectangle better be m times n. We want the notion to be additive. So if we have one figure F1 and another figure F2 right beside it, and together they make a figure F, then it's reasonable to suppose that the area of F is the sum of the area of F1 plus the area of F2. And a more subtle requirement that works really well, we'll see later on, is a notion of linearity. What that means is that if we have a triangle ABC, and we keep A and B fixed, and just vary C. Suppose we move C along a line, linearly, so with constant speed. Then we would expect that the area of this triangle should also behave linearly. That works up to a point with this notion, until we get to this zero area situation down here. And then after that it becomes positive again, and so the linearity is destroyed. To replace this notion with another one, the key is to replace squares with triangles. Triangles are a more flexible basis for a notion of area. And in fact, what we'll see now is that we don't really need triangles so much as oriented triangles. Okay, so what is an oriented triangle? Well, it is a triangle together with an orientation, which means we choose a way of going around the three vertices. We can either go around this way or we can go around this way. So a triangle has two possible orientations, and if we choose one of those possible orientations, we get what's called an oriented triangle. So when we say A1, A2, A3 with a vector sign over it, we mean the triangle A1, A2, A3 together with the orientation going this way. A1 first, then A2, then A3, then A1, then A2, and so on. So let's take that oriented triangle and we'll consider these two vectors, V1 emanating there, V2 emanating there. We'll suppose that those vectors have coordinates x1, y1 and x2, y2. Then in terms of those numbers, the signed area of the oriented triangle is defined to be this number here. It's x1, y2 minus x2, y1 over 2. This times this minus this times this all over 2. And that's an expression that we've seen quite a lot already in the series. Now, one thing we have to do is to demonstrate that that's actually well defined, that it doesn't depend on having chosen A1 as the basis for our vectors emanating. And that's accomplished by this following theorem. In this theorem, we use slightly different notation. Suppose that A1 is the point x1, y1, A2 is the point x2, y2, and A3 is the point x3, y3. Then the theorem is that this area that we've just defined up here turns out to be this expression. It's got 6 terms, they alternate plus and minus. x1, y2 minus x2, y1, those naturally go together. Then x2, y3 minus x3, y2, those naturally go together. Plus x3, y1 minus x1, y3, those naturally go together. This expression is one of the most important expressions in all of mathematics. It comes up in many, many different situations. And this expression is obviously, after you'll stare at it for a little while, it's cyclically symmetric. So in other words, if you interchange 1 with 2 and 2 with 3 and 3 with 1, then the whole thing stays the same. That's telling us that this notion here is actually independent of which vector we started our definition from. So this is a very important formula, and we could have also started with this as the definition of the signed area. Let's have a look at an example. So here is a triangle, A1, A2, A3, with points 1, 1, A1, A2 is 7, 3, A3 is 2, 5. And we would like to know what is the area of this triangle. Well, let's start off with our naive definition and take the area of this big rectangle, which is 6 times 4, and subtract the areas of these three green triangles. This one here has area 6 times 2 over 2. This one has area 5 times 2 over 2. And this one has area 1 times 4 over 2. When we calculate that out, we get 11 for the area of the triangle A1, A2, A3. Now let's have a look at that signed area definition. So we'll start with A1. We'll emanate from here, getting that vector and that vector. A1, A2 is the vector 6, 2. A1, A3 is the vector 1, 4. And then the definition says that, all right, the area is then 6 times 4 minus 2 times 1, all over 2, which is also 11. And what about that theorem expression that occurs? Well, if you plug in these various values, you get this times this minus this times this, and then plus this times this minus this times this, and then rotate it around, this times this minus this times this, all over 2. And you work that out, you get the same answer, 11. So all these notions agree, as they should. Another important case is when we think about a parallelogram instead of a triangle. So suppose that we have a vector here, AB, another vector, CD, and the parallelogram formed by those two vectors. Then, in this case, the area of this parallelogram will be twice the area of that triangle formed by those two vectors, so it will just be AD minus BC, not over 2, but just by itself. The real power of this definition of area comes about when we look at polygons, figures with more than 3 vertices. We're going to do that next time. I hope you'll join me. I'm Norman Wildberger, and thanks for listening.